Hey, I'm Alexi at Boost Power Marine, and I wanted to show you a little bit about these oil cooler thermostat setups that can potentially make your engine blow up if improperly set up originally. So you've probably seen these deals on your motor. This is a stock MerCruiser one. They have a little thermostat inside, and there's a little deal in here that goes up and down based on the oil temperature. The thought behind this is when you fire up your engine, you want to let the oil warm up, so you don't want it cooling for no reason on a stock application or a high performance application. Truly in boats that are high performance, the oil temperature is going to come up quickly anyway, but this takes the human element out of warming up your oil to a manufacturer's recommended oil temp. Okay, so if you look in here, basically when you start up your motor, the oil exits out of the block and goes to each side of this little valve, comes out of these ports and sends oil right basically to each side of the port in the oil cooler. The problem with that is that there's an air gap in there. And with an air gap in there, you can have potential problems. So the way we discovered it years and years ago is on the dyno. When you fire up a motor for the first time after a rebuild or the first time period, you know, we all pre-oil the engines. We run a pump and pre-oil the engine and spin it around and make sure oil's everywhere. And then, you know, we'll, if it's got a big oil cooler system on it, we'll fill the oil cooler with oil and the lines. That's the way we do it. The problem with this type of setup, whether it's new or used or whatever, when you fire up a motor and you have good oil pressure and you're running it on the dyno for the first time, everything's working great. But what people don't realize is that as soon as that oil temperature transitions from, say, 180 degrees to 200 when the valve opens, depending on what temperature setting that's in your oil thermostat, there's an intermittent gap of air in the system. So most shops that don't dyno or don't prime these things properly, they'll fire up an engine and they'll go release it to the customer and everything's great. Boat starts, runs perfect. They get on plane for the first time and they're driving, and all of a sudden, when the oil temperature hits 180, they get an intermittent beep on their dash, and if they have a dash warning system, because it got a loss of oil pressure for a split second, because of that transition and the fact that maybe they didn't prime the lines, or if this valve is acting up originally, and you know, it's supposed to kind of self-prime, but sometimes they don't. So everything's great, and then all of a sudden you spin a bearing because, you know, by the time your oil temperature gets 180 to 200 to 240, when this thing opens, you're already going maybe full throttle on a new motor. I mean, the oil doesn't get hot just sitting there. You have to be driving under load. So I guess what I'm trying to tell you is, make sure when you have an oil thermostat system of any kind, you actually open all the lines in the oil cooler and fill all the lines with oil to minimize this problem. They are designed to self-prime on each side. But remember, when you have oil coming out of one hose and another through a cooler, no matter what, there's going to be air in between it somewhere in that system. And if there's air in between it somewhere in that system, when that decides to flow toward the engine, that air gap is going with the oil. It's not going to go away. There's no bleeder in it. There's no way to bleed the air out because their oil cooler is usually mounted high. So, I mean, the only way we do it is we crack the line and put oil through it all the way to the bottom and then shut it before we even start the engine. If you don't do that, that air gap is going to follow right into your motor and you're going to have some kind of, it could be a split second where you don't get a buzzer. It could be 20 seconds because you have a giant oil cooler and there's a huge air gap in there. The problem is you're going to be under load 99% of the time when that oil thermostat turns on for the first time and bypasses to a cooler. So you don't want to run anything dry. You know, your bearings don't like it when you crank the motor dry in the first place. Imagine now you're wide open under load or close to it. And this goes for all the aftermarket ones that are on some of our big motors. We use thermostats for the oil system. Just depends on the region in which these things are going to be living in. Most of the time we try to take those kind of fail, anything that could fail off that, you know, potentially we won't need, but they are good to have. Again, depending on the region and the oil you use and the use of the boat, but make sure that the lines stay primed in the beginning. Because like I said, I'll revert back to the way we learned it is on the dyno, you fire up a motor, everything's good. You hold it at 2,500 RPM to break it in and, you know, vary the RPM to maybe 3,800 back and forth. All of a sudden, there's a loss of oil pressure, and then it comes back, and you're like, uh-oh, did I spin a bearing? What happened? Did the bypass valve fall out? Did this bad oil filter? And then you realize, oh, the oil thermostat just opened. Good thing we're just kind of warming the oil up with 10% load on the dyno versus if we had just put this in the boat and said, yep, everything's good, and here you go, and the guy goes out there with a full load in his boat and spins up a bearing because of it. You know, remember, in a high-performance engine, it's a lot more likely to do that because you're loading the bearing group a lot more than you are with a stock deal. So, again, look inside these things, clean them out. This one's filthy. You can see at any low spot, dirty Babbitt, Molly, whatever's in your oil, collects at the bottom. It also collects inside that little bypass. So when this thing gets to, say, 190 degrees, that thing closes. And it only allows the fittings to flow through the cooler. But remember, that air gap between these lines and where it comes back and into the engine or to the oil filter or any of that, that's quite a distance. As it is, I don't like having too much lines on oil systems. You know, when you have an oil filter head mounted convenient for you to change the oil, that's great. But it's not convenient for your bearings. Your bearings don't like to start up and idle for 10 to 15 seconds without adequate oil flow. And the high performance oil systems out there, a lot of them don't have check valves to hold oil up into the motor. So, you know, my rule of thumb is something taught to me by my father is crank the engine around and let oil move and then turn the ignition on. It's better for you. Get a little oil flow, especially in a turbocharged motor. You need oil going to those turbos before you turn the fire on. If not, you're going to be just prematurely wearing things, and who wants that, you know? So, again, fill those lines up. Fill your oil filters when you can. If they're upside down on a motor, we still kind of put about 20% of oil in them and shake them to saturate the paper, screw it back on. If you don't do that, it takes even that much longer to get oil to go through the paper to fire up your engine when you do an oil change. A lot of people don't think of that. They just buy a filter, screw it on, and start it up and just, well, I'll just wait another 15 seconds. Oh, there it is, the oil pressure. Any of those milliseconds you can save is milliseconds off of the bearing wear. So try to do whatever you can to keep oil in your system and the boat sitting for a while or high performance, whatever you're working on. Move oil around, it'll be better for you. Let that oil get places and then turn the engine on. Cranking a motor with, you know, no movement of oil. I mean, some of our engines, we actually put a sensor on it and it won't allow the ignition to turn on until it sees some kind of oil movement. A lot of stock engines are like that too. So anyway, hope that helps you out. Make sure you check that out on your next build or rebuild. And remember, if you have a bearing failure, my rule of thumb is take that whole oil cooler and throw it in the garbage can. Do not try to clean them. There's things inside there and little orifices inside there that you just can't get the metal out. You can't, and some systems are filtered before or after. Look, just throw it away. Spend the $300 or whatever it is. Get a new oil cooler. Don't take the chance of transferring the disease from your old motor to your new motor. Some of them are completely removable and you can take them out and clean them, but if you take, you better get a magnifying glass to make sure that there's not one piece of metal stuck in any of those tubes. And if you're worried in any way, put a filter on both ends of the thing. There's a lot of applications where we like on these tour boats that get constantly used, and when they decide to go bad, they go bad. We put a filter on each end so they get filtered going in the cooler and filtered going out of the cooler to protect the cooler itself. It's kind of extra work, but you know, depending on the use again, it might be necessary. So, all right, protect your engine, and we'll talk to you guys soon. Thanks.